the foundations of quantum theory rest on its symmetries. For example, it should be impossible to distinguish our universe from one that is a perfect mirror opposite in charge, handedness, and the direction of time. But one by one, these symmetries were found to be broken, threatening to break all of physics along with them. In his famous lectures on physics, Richard Feynman talks about what it means to expect the universe to be identical in the mirror, for it to be parity-symmetric. He invites us to imagine a clock in a mirror reflection. Numbers are backwards, components are all flipped left to right, and it ticks counterclockwise. And then he asks us to imagine building that same mirror clock in reality. Everything is constructed as though reflected. Numbers get painted backwards, every screw with right-handed thread or right spiraling coil is replaced with a left-handed version. Our intuition tells us that the mirror clock should tick in exactly the same way, except counterclockwise. Our intuition would be wrong. The laws of physics, and so the laws of clocks, are not symmetric to this sort of parity transformation. As we saw in our recent episode, the experiment that first proved this found that cobalt-60 nuclei decay by spitting an electron out in the opposite direction to their nuclear spin axis. But in a mirror-reflected universe, the same decay should be in the opposite direction, so with that spin axis, which is fundamentally different physical behavior. So what does this have to do with Feynman's clock? Well, he proposes a clock whose ticks are governed by the decay of cobalt-60. Imagine an array of cobalt-60 atoms in a magnetic field. The cobalt nuclei have angular momenta that will align with the magnetic field, let's say upwards, so the decay electrons travel down. A detector is placed to intercept those electrons, and the clock ticks with every captured electron. In our reflected clock, we need to replace the cobalt atoms with their parity inverted counterparts. But now the decay electrons travel upwards with the nuclear spin and away from the detector. Such a clock wouldn't tick at all. Taken to its literal extreme, a perfectly constructed mirror reflected clock behaves differently. So, what's the big deal? Well, the violation of parity symmetry poses a threat to an even deeper symmetry, Cpt symmetry, the combined flipping of charge, parity, and time. And this symmetry lies at the foundations of quantum field theory. Physics must work the same if we flip all of these properties. If not, physics as we know it goes out the window, which does seem like a big deal. To save physics, Richard Feynman proposes that we build a copy of our clock out of antimatter. Sure, Feynman, why not? Electrons become positrons, quarks become antiquarks, and vice versa, sending protons and neutrons to their anti-versions in the nuclei of our now anti-cobalt-60 and other anti-atoms. Sending matter to antimatter is the C part of CPT. Charge conjugation. All charges switch sign. Electric charge, but also quark color charge, weak hypercharge, etc. That's what a switch to antimatter means. How does this work in our antimatter clock? Well, antimatter atoms have negatively charged nuclei, which means their nuclear magnetic fields point in the opposite direction to regular matter, relative to their angular momentum. The magnetic field in our clock will align antimatter nuclei in the opposite direction to matter nuclei. So, in our mirror-reflected antimatter clock, the direction of the decay electrons are flipped, once due to the mirror reflection, and once due to the switch to antimatter. That leaves the electrons traveling in the original direction, down, and the clock ticks as normal. So, even though the universe isn't parity symmetric, maybe it is symmetric under a charge parity, a CP transformation. Send right to left, and send matter to antimatter. At first glance, this CP symmetry appears to hold, not just in imaginary clocks, but also in the particles of the Standard Model. The great parity-violating process is the weak interaction, which only affects left chiral fermions. Right chiral fermions don't feel the weak force at all. But the opposite is true of antimatter. Right chiral antifermions feel the weak force, while left chiral antifermions don't. So a charge parity flip leaves you in the same situation regarding the weak interaction. If CP is what we call a good symmetry, then you shouldn't be able to do any experiment to tell whether you're in this universe or in a CP-transformed universe. All physics should work the same, theoretically. But don't get too comfortable. We haven't looked at what the experimentalists have to say about this. You may recall from the parity episode that the first hint of parity violation was the so-called tau-theta problem, which turned out to result from the fact that the positively charged kaon meson decayed in ways that violated parity conservation. It turns out that these kaon particles are great at catching the universe doing weird stuff. In 1964, James Cronin and Val Fitch looked at the outcomes of the decay of neutral kaons. These things are extra weird. A neutral kaon is a quantum mix of its own particle and antiparticle. And there are two ways to do this mixing, yielding two types of neutral kaon. One type, let's call it Ks, is short-lived and has what we call an even Cp state, which just means it doesn't change under a combined charge parity transformation. The other type, KL, is long-lived and has an odd Cp state. Its wave function gets multiplied by -1 on a Cp transformation, and that means, well, it's different to the Ks state. If Cp symmetry is conserved, Ks and KL should never transform into each other because they have different Cp symmetries. Cronin and Fitch tested this by sending a bunch of both types of neutral kaon down a tube with a detector at the far end. The Ks particles should never have made the journey given their short lifetimes, and yet a small but significant number of decay products from Ks particles were found at the far end. The only explanation is that KL particles oscillated into Ks's, violating charge parity conservation. Well, that sucks. Our mirror-reflected antimatter clock doesn't work right after all. Nice one, Feynman. And that's not the worst of it. The violation of Cp symmetry has much more dire consequences than a broken imaginary clock, although it does have a lot to do with time. This also suggests that time reversal symmetry is broken. And to understand this, we do need to reverse time a bit and go back to the 1950s. Which coincidentally saw the breaking of another imaginary clock in Hill Valley, California. The 1950s was also the decade of the foundations of quantum field theory, and as QFT emerged, it became clear that there is a certain symmetry that's not just intuitively expected, but also theoretically required. Starting with Julian Schwinger's spin statistics theorem in 1951, it became increasingly clear that quantum field theory demands symmetry under the combined action of charge conjugation, parity inversion, and time reversal. The very axiomatic foundations of QFT state that an antimatter mirror-reflected time-reversed version of our universe should have exactly the same laws of physics. This is the Cpt theorem. Quantum field theory should be Cpt invariant. And we know that quantum field theory is right, at least as far as it goes. It's just about the most right theory we've ever come up with. I'll get back to what this new time reversal symmetry, the T in Cpt, actually means. But for now, let's just accept that the laws of physics must work the same under a simultaneous flipping of charge, parity, and the direction of time. That was certainly the view of physicists in the late 1950s. So, then come the experiments that show violations, first of P, then of Cp symmetry. Big deal, we still have T, Cpt can be conserved. But here's the issue. If Cp symmetry is violated, and Cpt symmetry holds, then T symmetry must also be violated. Why? Because that time reversal operation needs to bring us from a broken Cp reflected universe into a fixed Cpt universe. But that means a T transformation from our working Cpt universe sends us to a broken Cp universe. Ergo, time reversal transformation changes the way the universe behaves. Time symmetry is out the window, theoretically. That sounds bad. Isn't physics supposed to work the same whether we go forwards or backwards in time? Well, as we talked about in this episode, don't we absolutely require time reversal symmetry in order to conserve quantum information, which itself is required for all of quantum mechanics to make sense? Well, to get at this, we're going to need to talk about what we mean by reversing time. The most obvious interpretation of time reversal is literally reversing the arrow of time and causing the universe to travel backwards in time. That is not what we mean by the T in Cpt, which I'll explain in a minute, But first, let's think about this simple type of T-transformation as a literal rewind. Rewind the universe and you get back to where you started, pretty much by definition. So, presumably, quantum information is conserved in this type of time reversal. Mathematically, the particles in a rewinding universe actually look like they underwent a charge parity inversion. Matter that was going forward in time looks like parity-flipped antimatter going backwards in time. This interpretation of antimatter as time-reverse matter was first proposed by Ernst Stuckelberg in 1941, but is now largely associated with Richard Feynman. It's essential to his path integral approach to quantum mechanics and to Feynman diagrams. Maybe that's why he was so into building antimatter clocks. So yeah, the universe is not symmetric under this simple version of T-reversal. It's the precise inverse of a Cp transformation. The two undo each other. Do a Cp transformation and then a simple T transformation and you get back to where you started. If Cp is violated, then this simple time reversal is also violated. And we see this violation in the asymmetry between matter and antimatter. Then there's the whole entropy business, although its connection to quantum mechanics is still not well understood. But like I said, this simple interpretation of T as rewinding the universe is not what we usually mean by the T in CPT. That T is more accurately thought of as flipping the direction of the evolution of a physical system. An explosion becomes an implosion, and particle decay becomes particle creation. You're not rewinding time, you're not converting matter to antimatter, you're just reversing all momentum and spin. Essentially, you're taking all particles in the universe and pointing them back in the direction they came from. If the T in CPT is conserved, then after reversing all particle motion, those particles should perfectly retrace their steps and perfectly reverse all reactions in their histories. As this motion-reverse universe evolves forward in time, it should end up back in its starting configuration. On the other hand, broken T-symmetry says that if you do this reversal, the future won't perfectly mirror the past. One prediction of this T-symmetry is that all processes should take the same amount of time going forwards as backwards. For example, a quantum transition between one particle type and another should take the same time in either direction. And that gives us a test. In 2012, physicists from the Babar collaboration at the Stanford Linear Accelerator Center tested the speed with which B mesons transition between two types. In a T-symmetric universe, the speeds should be the same in either direction. They were not the same. Reversing the direction of the interaction changed something fundamental about the physics, indicating a violation of T-symmetry. But remember, killing T-symmetry is a good thing because it may save CPT symmetry. The last 70 years have been a true rollercoaster ride for the symmetries of nature. As experiments found broken symmetries one by one, first parity, then charge parity, the hallowed CPT symmetry looked in danger unless we gave up on the symmetry of time itself. But now, with time reversal symmetry also looking like it's broken, the Cpt theorem looks safe. Feynman's mirror-reflected antimatter clock will work just fine, but as well as ticking backwards, every atom, every subatomic particle needs to tick backwards also. So, we've discovered our perfect mirror universe. It's a reflection of all three: charge, space, time. Hey everyone, I'm back from the event horizon, aka Australia, which as you know is the CPT inverted version of Canada. The last episode before the break was why string theory is wrong. Today, I want to address the comments to that episode. I'll catch up on last week's comments next time. In fact, I really want to address a few points made by Field Strength on the PBS Spacetime subreddit. They covered all the most important points. Now first, I want to clarify that despite the title Why String Theory is Wrong, the point of the video was not to argue that string theory is wrong, instead it was a playful follow-up to Why String Theory is Right. I'll reiterate my real opinion on the matter after addressing Field Strength's specific and very reasonable criticisms. In the video, we note that string theory pretty much requires supersymmetry in order to be right, and that supersymmetry hasn't yet been detected at the expected energy scale. That's the energy scale expected if supersymmetry is to also provide a neat resolution to the standard model's hierarchy problem. But string theory doesn't require supersymmetry to be at that energy scale at all. For the purpose of string theory, supersymmetric particles could be far beyond the energies detected by the Large Hadron Collider. So, field strength argues that our current non-detection of supersymmetric particles is no falsification of string theory. And, of course, that's correct. But I didn't say otherwise. Apologies if it seemed implied. However, I do argue that this non-detection is a bit of a hiccup. Supersymmetry is highly compelling if it provides an answer to the hierarchy problem and gives us superstring theory. It would be odd if supersymmetry existed as part of superstring theory but did nothing to help with the hierarchy problem because it was at far too high an energy scale. But then, as I did mention in the video, the current Large Hadron Collider results do not yet completely rule out all energy scales useful for the hierarchy problem. Only at the energy scales that solve the problem most neatly. Field strength's other point is that the large undefined parameter space of string theory, the so-called string landscape, is no more of a problem for string theory than it is for the standard model. I totally agree. In fact, it's less of a problem for string theory because in the standard model, many parameters are hopelessly unconstrained by the theory itself, while in string theory, it's arguable that only one parameter is hopelessly unconstrained. My point is not that string theory is more wrong than the standard model, it's just that it's not yet right in this sense. To quote me, it was never really right. And to quote Peter Woit, quoting Pauli, it's not even wrong. The point being that while not wrong, there's not yet a way to properly test its rightness or wrongness. Field strength's final point is that the untestability of string theory is connected to the extreme energy scale of quantum gravity, and that problem is not unique to string theory. Now, we do talk about that in our first episode on general quantum gravity, so apologies for not repeating it here. So, yeah, string theory is apparently not yet testable, but I disagree with those who say that this type of untestability means that the field is not science. String theory may be currently untestable due to the energy scales involved, but the universe has no obligation to make itself currently testable to any particular particle collider building technology level. It's under no obligation to make every next layer of reality accessible to the next generation of physicists. We blasted through several reality layers from atoms to quantum fields in the past 100 years or so, but maybe the next layer will take another 1,000 years more. Randy Copeland brilliantly notes that physicists are a bit like house MD, trying to find a diagnosis that fits the symptoms, with the symptoms being all of reality itself. Nice observation. Also makes me feel better when I put my title down when I buy airline tickets in the hope of getting an upgrade. I'm still dreading the day when the crew come to me because there's some medical emergency on board, and I have to tell them what type of doctor I am.